Today's speaker connects with students through his unique and engaging perspective on student life. He has shared the stage with NFL stars, appeared on Sirius Radio, and authored 6 books. Back in high school, though, he just blended in. He followed others, made poor choices, and wasn't true to himself. In short, he was a fake. It's from that history that he leads students to honor themselves with the choices they make and teaches how to be responsible and create a contagious attitude. His mission is to make students aware of the potential they have to be great when they realize that their choices will affect their future. Here to help us fire up our futures, please welcome Jerry Ackerman.
Good morning, New Jersey. My name's Jerry. Say, hey, Jerry.
Jerry.
On the count of three, tell me your name. 1, 2, 3. Awesome. Yeah, I know that you have a lot of speakers that you probably hear throughout the year. I want to have an honest conversation today. Can we do that? Can we have an honest conversation? I really want to do something fairly simple this morning. I simply would like to ask you 3 questions and then tell you 5 things. I want to ask you 3 questions and tell you 5 things. 5 things for the ladies and 5 things for the fellas. And we'll get to that in a moment. And I have to give credit to Kate Connor for helping me out with a couple of those on the girls' side. We'll get to that in a minute here. But I want to ask you, I believe, some of the most important questions you have to answer. And I know right now for a lot of you, you are having to answer all kinds of questions. What are you going to do with your future? Where are you going to spend the next 4 years of life? Are you going to get married? Are you going to have 2.5 kids? I mean, I know there's all those kinds of questions, and I think they're good questions to ask. But I don't believe that the questions you have to answer in the future are going to be helpful if you do not answer these 3 questions well. So I want to tell you what those 3 are, then come back and unwrap them for a moment. First question is, how will you handle your stuff? Second question, how will you handle adversity? And a third question, how will you handle your time? So how will you handle your stuff? Raise your hand if you have a cell phone. Come on, raise your hand. Who doesn't? No. All right, raise your hand if you have an iPod. You got an iPod? Is that outdated? Raise your hand if you have a computer or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 maybe. Raise your hand if you have a DVR, old school VCR. Oh, yeah. Who has a TV in the room? You got a TV in your room? Who has a set of wheels? It's your car, it's yours, you drove it. Yeah. Do you realize that for some of you out there, the whole way through that litany, you had your hand up the whole time? You're like, uh-huh, yeah, got it, mm-hmm, check, check, check. Oh, can you do this for me? Humor me for a minute. If you would, in your head, on one side of your brain, just for like 2 or 3 seconds, write down all the stuff that you have. Go ahead. Now on the other side of your brain, in 2 or 3 seconds, I want you to write down all the stuff that your parents have. Go ahead. Now if we were in a workshop setting, and I asked you to write those down on a piece of paper, and you did not label the column as to who was who, for a lot of you in this room, just based upon the stuff that you have, I would not be able to tell who's the child and who's the parent. I say this, and I don't mean to slap you across the face. I just say it because this is what I think. I think that your generation, more than any generation to walk on planet Earth, is living a lifestyle that you cannot afford. Some of you might not agree with that, but raise your hand again, students, if you have a cell phone. Come on, raise your hand because you like it, you love it, you go to sleep with it. You know. Keep your hand up. I have a follow-up question. My follow-up question, keep your hand up, is this. Keep your hand up if and only if you pay for your entire cell phone bill. And you're not number 5 on the Happy Family Plan, because that doesn't count. Look at that. 90% went down. All right, hands down. See, I don't know. I mean, some of you, if I was to come up to you and say, hey, how many minutes do you have on your cell phone plan? You would be like, it doesn't matter. Really? I was at a high school a few weeks ago in Missouri. A mother came up after a presentation. She had this piece of paper in her hand, and she said, look at this piece of paper. It's like, okay. She said, this is my cell phone bill from last month. At the bottom is the amount I have to pay for my daughter's texting. So I took the paper. I looked at it. The number was just shy of $4,300. Now, there's all kinds of wrong with how it got to that point, but some of it is how this student did not equate with what she had or what she was doing with a dollar amount. And I seriously ask you this question because I believe it's one of the most important in your future. How are you going to handle your stuff? And unless you've had your head in the sand over the last few years, you have had an upfront front row seat to what it's like to people that have not answered that question well. Some of you are living in those homes where that question has not been answered well, and you can cut the tension with a knife. You know what I mean by not being able to answer that question well. I mean, I'm not anti-stuff. Don't get me wrong, but I am saying that if you do not understand how to live with what you have and manage the stuff that you have with what you have, it's going to be one of the biggest downfalls for many of you in this room. Because if you acquire stuff that you cannot manage, you all of a sudden become stuck to it. And that stuff now is managing you, and you can't manage it. I see a lot of people throughout this country that are living this lifestyle, and if they could do anything to get out of this situation, they would do it in a minute. Young people, how will you handle your stuff? Hey, get stuff, that's fine. Have a great career, have money to get the stuff. But I will say this, if it becomes where it's managing you instead of you managing it, it's going to be very difficult to move forward, to pursue your dreams, to fulfill every opportunity that is given you. If we do not answer the question, how will I handle my stuff? Well, second question, how will you handle adversity? Raise your hand if you have no idea what adversity means. You're like, I don't have any idea. There's a few. Adversity is hard times. Hard times, hard things that come in your life. Raise your hand if you've had a hard time. You have some adversity the last couple years. You've had some adversity. Anybody? Yeah. Some of you in here, you know, you're like, hey, I haven't had a whole lot of adversity. Things are pretty good. That's all right. I will just say this, though. For everyone in this room, I can guarantee you that adversity's coming. And I believe that when adversity comes, you have two choices. I've been through some, and I believe that I've had two choices whenever that piece of adversity has come into my life. First one is this. When adversity comes, you can allow it to crush you. You can allow it to bury you. You can allow it to just run you into the muck of life. You can ignore it. You can walk away from it. You can do that. That's a choice. Or when adversity comes, you can say, I'm going to make the most and the best of it. I was in Illinois a few years ago talking about adversity in a keynote for an FFA group there, and large group, probably 5,000 or 6,000 students. Thought I did a really good job. I was outside in the lobby selling my merchandise, t-shirts, books, having a good time. Students all around my table until Stephen came up. Man, Stephen, he was mad. He was just torqued off of me, man. He came running up, busting through everybody, all the students. He came up. He was wagging his finger in my face. He said, Jerry, he said, man, you have no idea about me. He said, you don't know my story. You have no idea about me. And you come here and say, I should make the most and the best of whatever comes in my life. He said, you don't know me. You don't know my story. And after I calmed him down, I was like, whoa, okay. The first thing I said was, Stephen, you're right. Man, I have no idea about your story? None. But I'm pretty sure you don't know my story either, Stephen. I said, you probably don't know that my best friend in high school, 3 weeks before we graduated high school, jumped off a 1,200-foot cliff and killed himself. I said, you probably don't know that three of my best friends in undergraduate school on consecutive Thanksgiving weekends on their ride home from college for that holiday were killed in car accidents. I said, you probably didn't know that 12 years ago I almost had to file personal bankruptcy. 4 years ago my wife had a miscarriage, and 2 years ago my dad had a massive stroke. I said, you probably didn't know that, did you? And see, it's not about how much bad stuff you have compared to somebody else's, and, you know, whoever has more is the winner. The question is, when it comes into your life, how are you going to handle it? I mean, for me, the latest bout was nearly 2 years ago exactly. I was on a stage in Missouri. My phone was blowing up. I just had a feeling something wasn't right. Got off stage. It was my mom. She said, you got to come to Indianapolis. Something happened to your dad. I raced to Indianapolis, got to the hospital, opened the door, and there in the bed, I saw my dad, and I knew right away that something had gone terribly wrong. And for the next 3 minutes, he asked me what time it was for about 40 or 50 times. And the last 2 years has been a slow train wreck. My dad now weighs 86 pounds. He doesn't know who I am anymore. He lays in a fetal position in the nursing home, and hospice told me that he has about 3 weeks to live. And for the last 2 years, back when he knew me, back when this happened, I had a choice. I had a choice, how am I going to handle this piece of adversity? Because here it came, no fault of my own, but here it shows up. And I had two choices. I could have said, this sucks, this is not fair. I could have let it push me under. I could have let it bury me. I could have ignored it and turned away, and that was tempting. Or I could have said, and what I did as a conscious choice was, I want to make the most and the best of it. So for the last 2 years, I've tried to do that. Back when he knew me, I sat beside his bedside countless times, hearing stories I had never, ever heard before. For the last 2 years, there were times when we would laugh about things, and we didn't even know what we were laughing about. You ever done that? You're like, why are we even laughing? We're just laughing. And for the last 2 years, my dad has told me that he's loved me more than any time I can remember in the last 40 years of my life. And you know what? I would not trade these last 2 years for anything in the world. But it clearly began with a choice. How will you handle adversity? How will you handle your stuff? How you handle adversity? Last question here for you to pause and consider is, how will I handle my time? Did you know that we all have a dash? Do you know that? You go to any graveyard, you see a tombstone, you see a number, followed by another number, and in the middle there's a dash. Some are longer than others, some are shorter, but we all have a dash. We all have a set amount of time that we've been given on earth, and my question for you is, how are you handling that time? We all have different amounts. Amy Winehouse, she was 27 when she passed away. She probably didn't see that coming. Heath Ledger, he was 28 when he died. He probably didn't see that coming. Whitney Houston, she was 48. She probably should have saw that coming, I guess. Dick Clark, he was 82. Steve Jobs was 56. We all have different dash lengths. What are you doing with your time? Raise your hand if after school you go home, you get a bag of Doritos and sit and play PlayStation. That's kind of your first thing you do. There's some honest people. All right, raise your hand if after school is out, you text everybody on planet Earth. I mean, that's like the first thing you do. All right, I'm not getting a lot of participation, so let me ask the real honest-to-goodness question. Who plays Call of Duty till 4 in the morning? You know who you are. You know, especially with this group, when it comes to time, why wasn't there a lot of participation there? because this isn't the problem. The problem isn't wasting time. In fact, if I was to go up to you right now without a definition and I just asked you, are you busy? Raise your hand if you would say yes. You would say, yep, that's me. Look at that. Ton of us. Hands down. Now, it's interesting because I see this everywhere I go in our culture with students that are younger and younger, that they're declaring themselves busy. And it's very true that for a lot of high school students, I mean, you are scheduled every 30 minutes. I mean, you got something going on. Now, you got to understand my heart. I'm a pretty good worker. In fact, I'm the laziest, ambitious guy you know. I mean, I work hard for what I do. I run my own business, so I get the fact of working hard. But I will tell you this, that 12 years ago, I got off the busy train. I mean, 12 years ago, I was working, I kid you not, 70, 80 hours a week, but I was pulling in the cash. Woo! And I remember there was one day I drove home on my nice property in my big giant house and my big giant car, and I pulled up into the driveway. I turned the engine off and I just sat there. And I don't know what caused me just to sit there, but I did. And all of a sudden my mind went to the three little ones that were inside the house at the moment, all at that time, all under the age of 5. And I remember thinking about those three, and I thought, you know what? I don't remember anything about their life as babies. In fact, in that moment, if you'd have come up to the car and you'd have shown me three pictures of three infants, of my three kids, I would not have been able to tell you who was who, because I was never home. And it was that moment 12 years ago when I decided I'm going to get off the busy train. Because what I was doing was trading in this career, this money, whatever you see, and missing out on what some of us would say most important things in our life are, which is our family. See, being busy is kind of interesting to me, and I've studied it quite a bit. There's two sides of the coin. I mean, for us that are busy, I mean, I'm a recovering busy person, but for some of us in here, we would say we're busy. And for some of us in here, when we say we're busy, we're proud of it, aren't we? I mean, we kind of wear it like a badge of honor. I mean, if we have a conversation with someone, we kind of feel good about the fact that we're busy. Have you ever had a conversation like this? Like, you're talking to somebody, I don't know who you are, but you were talking to this person, and they're like, hey, what are you up to? And you're like, huh, you know, I'm like working three jobs, and, you know, I'm volunteering at the church, got my hands in a couple organizations over here, I'm writing a novel on the side, I'm practically hooked up to coffee, but everything's good. What are you up to? And they say, nothing. Now, we wouldn't say this, but inside, what are we thinking as we're smiling at them? Slacker. I mean, isn't that what we think? We kind of think that if I am busy, that I will be successful. That if I'm busy, I'm more important than you. That if I'm busy, I will have a leg up. And yet I know a lot of busy people. And if I stopped them in the middle of their busyness, I would say, hey, what are you aiming for? And a lot of them have no idea. They're just on this train. I don't know, but I got to go to a meeting in 15 minutes. And see, when I'm busy, man, I forget a lot of things. I forget how to breathe. I forget how to sit down and actually have a drink and enjoy it for its taste instead of its caffeine intake so I can stay up another 3 hours. And I forget how to really have a conversation. See, being busy, I think, robs us from a lot of the present. I'm not saying don't work hard. Listen, give it all you got. I mean, these two days, show what you have. But I will say this, you go back into life here in a couple days and you start going to business as usual, let me encourage you to live for the present. Live right now. Enjoy what you have right now with the people that you have right now. Because it may be different tomorrow. This isn't just my own advice. I get some of my best research from talking with old people. Really old people. My good friend Oscar, for instance, he's 103. Oscar's awesome, man. He will tell you anything. He doesn't care. I was at Oscar's here a few weeks ago. We went into his house. He still owns his own house. He's a millionaire in Indianapolis. Was, he still is. And he invited me in. He's like, hey, come on in, Jerry. And we sit in the back porch. And, you know, I just ask questions. I listen. So he talks. For 2 hours, we talked a few weeks ago. I will tell you this. A man, he's 103, owns several businesses, is still an incredibly rich person. And those 2 hours that we talked, never once did he tell me how many business deals he struck, where the places he went to in the world, or how many meetings he went to. Those 2 hours were instead filled with the people that he impacted over those 103 years and the people he wished he would have impacted in those 103 years. And it's really a lesson to me. Hopefully it's a message to you that when you're, if you are fortunate to be 103, sitting on your back porch, drinking lemonade or whatever was mixed in that lemonade, that you will be conscious of the fact and be thankful for the fact that you put people first and not things first. How will you handle your stuff? How will you handle adversity? And how will you handle your time? Now to some fun things. Can we have a little bit of fun? Like four of us? All right, good. Listen, now I take a little bit of chance here to say what I'm about to say, but I've been giving this talk for a while, especially to older students. I believe that there are some things as leaders, even if you don't think you're a leader, I think everybody ends up being a leader because somebody's watching you. These are things that I don't think we deal with. These are issues as young people that I think we just tend to rather not discuss. And I'm just going to lay them out to you today. I want you to ponder them. I know there's going to be some pushback. Some of you are not going to like this. In fact, some of you in here, you're going to be very uncomfortable in your seat with what I have to say. Good. But I got to preface what I'm about to say to tell you this, that I am a proud father of 5 children. I know some adults are like, what is he thinking? I have 4 daughters and 1 son. Oh, yeah, a lot of estrogen in my house, you know what I'm saying?